The last speech of this session is a very interesting topic, by the way. A husband's responsibility towards his wife and family. Aftab ji means.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. Amma ba'du fa'uzu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa min ayatihi an khalaqa lakum min anfusikum azwajan litaskunu alayha wa ja'ala bainakum mawaddatan wa rahma. Inna fi zalika layatin liqaumin yatafakkarun. And one of his signs is this, that he has created wives for you from among yourselves, that you may find peace of mind in them, and that he has put love and tenderness between you. In that, surely are signs for people who reflect. Chapter 30, verse 22. All praise and glory belongs to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, who created the heavens and the earth, and who made our beloved Holy Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, the brightest star in the galaxy of prophets. He who not only brought a complete and comprehensive code of life and way of life, as we just heard, but he also showed us how to put Allah Ta'ala's commandments in real life. The topic that has been given to me today is husband's responsibility towards wife and family. As a complete and comprehensive code of life, Islam not only describes the true spirit of this relationship and the roles and responsibilities and checks and balances that are needed to make this relationship work, but the examples from the beloved life of our Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam are really like lampposts that illuminate a straight path for all of us. Respected brothers, the family is the brick that forms the foundation from which a benevolent and beneficial society emerges. A family unit is composed of individuals who have permanent relationships established between them. Being married is being a state of being united to your spouse in a consensual and contractual manner that is organized by law. I will inshallah attempt to present my humble understanding of the principal Islamic teachings that cover the financial, emotional, social, and spiritual aspects of this relationship. But before I do that, it is important to note that Allah Ta'ala has granted equal status to men and women in society. No one has superior rights over the others. As Allah Ta'ala has clearly said in the Holy Quran, "Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum," that verily the most honorable among you in the sight of Allah Ta'ala is the most righteous among you. Now, Allah Ta'ala, as our creator, He's our creator. He has given us all the strengths and faculties that we possess. He knows our weaknesses better than we do. And therefore, when it comes to the question of allocation of roles and responsibility in marital and family life, those have been assigned to us in alignment with those with our respective strengths. In verse 34 of Surah Al-Nisa, Allah Ta'ala says, "Ar-rajalu qawwamuna 'ala an-nisaa'i bima fazlallahi ba'dhum 'ala ba'din wa bima anfaqu min amwalihim." Men are guardians over women because Allah has made some of them excel others, and because they, the men, spend of their wealth. Now in this verse, Allah Ta'ala has clearly stated that husbands have been given more responsibility to make this relationship work. Not only Allah Ta'ala has explained that role of guardianship that has been given to husbands, the reasons and justification of those have been clearly outlined as well. And it is clear from this verse that the basic task of providing for your family, the financial needs of the family, rest squarely with husbands. Be it clothing, feeding, shelter, whatever needs the family has, that responsibility rests squarely with husbands. In Islam, wives do not have any obligation, any duty whatsoever, to go out and make a living to support the family life. Now, unfortunately, many men either focus or choose to remember only the partial meaning of this verse. And they take the role of guardianship for granted and focus instead on the status of guardianship as if that accrues more right to them. And they forget that the true spirit of this verse is not that husbands have better rights. Rather, the focus is that husbands have more responsibility as a head of households. Respected brothers, having explained that husbands have this role of guardianship, Allah Ta'ala has also given us a perfect formula to make, to execute on this responsibility and to make this relationship work. A relationship that is created between two equal partners who have been given different but equitable responsibilities to make this relationship work. And the true spirit that should be the guiding principle and the shining light with respect to this relationship is contained in the verse that I recited in the beginning. In that verse, in explaining the marital relationship, Allah Ta'ala did not choose to explain the higher rights or the lower rights or higher responsibility or the lower responsibilities in this relationship of marriage. Rather, Allah Ta'ala chose the beautiful concept of love and tenderness to explain what this relationship is meant to be and what it takes to make this relationship work. Islam describes the marital relationship as one of warmth and security. Marriage is a relationship of comfort, trust, loyalty, mercy, confidence, affection, and love. And husbands, as the guardians of the women and head of household, have to expect a greater responsibility in that regard. In verse 190 of chapter 7, Allah Ta'ala has said, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَجَعَلَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا لِيَسْكُنَ عَلَيْهَا. He it is who has created you from a single soul and made therefrom its mate that he might find comfort in her. That obligation and that concept that husbands and wife are created from a single soul means that that responsibility and the obligation of that comfort that this verse talks about is mutual. And although that mutual relationship is of warmth and security, it does go through different difficulties. Mutual compromise most of the time, and at certain times, frustrations. But what we need to remember, that is the love and tenderness that is needed to navigate through any storms that the marriage goes through. Whenever the marriage is going through the choppy waters that are caused by sometimes real and many a times perceived issues and disputes, the oars that are needed to take this ship ashore are made of love and tenderness. And yes, both husbands and wife have that mutual obligation to bring that love and tenderness into the relationship. But husbands, as the head of households, have to work harder at it. Perhaps that is due to a different genetic makeup of men. Men tend to be less emotional and sometimes are perceived to be less capable of being tender. That is where we need to take a look at the life of our beloved Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah Ta'ala has said, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا, that verily you have in the Prophet of Allah an excellent model. When it comes to the treatment of wives, we can literally spend hours upon hours of discussing the kind treatment by Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam of his wives. I'll just give a couple of very quick examples to illustrate the point. We have all heard Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying that women should be treated as if they are made of crystal. We all know that crystal requires very tender and careful handling, and a little bit of carelessness can permanently destroy or blemish its beauty. Not only our beloved Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said these words, he demonstrated that throughout his life as to how to act upon that. I'll just give you one quick example. On a return journey from Battle of Khaybar, Rasul Akram sallallahu alaihi wasallam took the shawl that he was wearing and made a cushion out of that so that his wife, Hazrat Safiya, who was accompanying radiyallahu ta'ala anha, who was accompanying him in that journey, could sit comfortably on the back of the camel. And when she was ready for the ride, you know what he did? He bent down and offered his knee so that she can step on his knee to get on the back of the camel. Perhaps a very small gesture, but a big lesson for all of us. Imagine the beloved of Allah Ta'ala, the Master Prophet, the Commander-in-Chief of the Muslim Army, returning from a victorious campaign, showing that degree of tenderness and love in public for his wife. On this topic, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam writes in Ruhani Khazain, volume 4, page 14, that, and this is when he was discussing one of his revelations, Hazur says, and I quote, "There is a lesson in this revelation for the whole Jama'at, that the wives should be treated with love and tenderness. They are not their servants. Indeed, a marriage is a contract between a man and a woman. So ensure that you do not violate that contract. Allah Ta'ala has said, wa'ashiru hunna bil ma'rufi, which means live with the wives with kindness." In Malfuzat, volume 3, page 300, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam has been quoted to have said that the relationship between husbands and wives should be like that of two real and sincere friends. Wives are the primary witness of a man's noble moral values and relationship with Allah. How is it possible to have a positive relationship with Allah Ta'ala if he's not even capable of having a positive relationship with his wife? Hazrat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that the best among you is the one who is best with his wife. A fruitful thought for us to think about whether we are taking the elementary steps of establishing a positive relationship with Allah tabaraka ta'ala. Respected brothers, let me switch gears and cover the Islamic teachings in the social life. That's an area where lack of attention or carelessness can really lead to a situation where the relationship can become totally devoid of the love and the warmth and security that I discussed. And the relationship can take a horrendous downward spiral. Those social responsibilities are summarized beautifully in verse 187 of Surah Al-Baqarah. And in that portion of the verse, Allah Ta'ala has said about the husbands and wife, "Hunna labasun lakum wa antum labasul hunna," that they are sort of a garment for you and you are sort of a garment for them. In this verse, Allah Ta'ala has chosen a metaphor that is very simple to understand, and anybody can understand, to understand the true nature of the relationship between husband and wife. We all know that the garments serve three basic functions in social life. Firstly, it's protection from the harsh weather, be it hot or cold. It's the enhancement of our beauty by hiding away any physical impurities that we may have. And thirdly, and more importantly, it's the protection of our modesty. In the family life, both husbands and wives have been given the task to perform these three functions for each other. Husbands, as a head of household, obviously has to take more responsibility in that regard. Therefore, a wife should always be able to rightfully expect her husband to be an effective shield for her, like a beautiful and reliable and comfortable garment that can help protect her from the hot and the cold of the social life. And as a true enhancement of her status in the social circles that we belong to, she should rightfully expect that her husband to be protecting the family secrets and her honor by not out there complaining about whatever issues that or complaints that the husbands might have. Brothers, when Allah Ta'ala made husbands a sort of a garment for the wives, that responsibility and that obligation is absolute, it's not relative. That means he cannot be discussing whatever complaints he might have with the family members, mothers, sisters, brothers, uncle, aunts, the friends in the social circle that we belong to. On this topic, Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is reported to have said that Allah will not ever let him enter paradise who cares little as to who shares his wife's privacy. There is an even harsher warning on this topic in another hadith, in which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The people of the worst stature with Allah on the day of judgment are men who confide in their wives, and wives who confide in their husbands, and then they spread each other's secrets around." It is very unfortunate that sometimes we see far too many incidents where in the marital relationship where there are disputes, and both parties are out there trying to exceed each other in counting how many faults their partners have. That kind of behavior is especially hurtful when that is exercised in front of children, sometimes intentionally to cause insult to the other party. Now, in the last few minutes that I have, let me cover a husband's most important responsibility, which is with respect to the spiritual life and the spiritual and moral training of wives and family. And that is clearly the most important responsibility that husbands have. Allah Ta'ala's commandments to bring love and tenderness into this relationship should never be misunderstood to mean that when it comes to the matter of attaining spirituality or seeking knowledge, that husbands should not drive that discipline out of love and tenderness. It is simply, as Muslim men, it is simply not good enough for us to strive to become good, righteous Muslim. What our role really is meant to be is that we are capable of and taking steps to ensure that we can train the next generation of righteous Muslims, next generation of righteous Muslim men and women. The righteous woman is the pillar and cornerstone and foundation of family life and is seen as the greatest comfort in man's life. Rasulullah Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that this world is just a temporary convenience, and the best comfort in this world is a righteous woman. Marrying a righteous woman and then helping her to maintain and enhance her level of righteousness is clearly a fundamental responsibility of a Muslim husband. Allah Ta'ala has promised a great higher status for those people who say, وَالَّذِينَ يَكُولُونَ رَبَّنَا حَبْلَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَزُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةً عَيْنًا وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. And those who say, "Our Lord, grant us of our wives and children the delight of our eyes and make us model for the righteous." Chapter 25, verse 75. In this verse, there are three critical responsibilities that are placed on Muslim husbands. And in that regard, we should keep in mind that we cannot pay lip service to that concept. We cannot just simply be making that prayer and hoping that somehow that happens. Muslim men, as a head of households, have to take steps to make sure that that dream and that desire can become a reality. For that to happen, Muslim husbands have to become effective leaders. Now, I realize that all of you know that there are hundreds or perhaps thousands of books and articles that have been written to describe what effective leadership is. I personally like a very simple example, which is very easy to remember. Those are three things that are needed in an effective leader. Know the way, go the way, show the way. Know the way meaning we need to know what it takes to become righteous. However, that is not good enough. Second step is more important. Go the way. Live your life as a righteous person so that you can show what it takes. And more importantly, showing the way, meaning hold the hands of your wives and children and lead them on the path that will lead to the nearness of Allah. I'll conclude by reading out a brief excerpt from the writings of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi on that topic. He was explaining his practice. Hazur writes, and I quote, "I formally pray on a daily basis in this manner. Firstly, I pray for myself that may Allah make me do such tasks that show Allah's majesty and His happiness with me. Secondly, I pray for my family that they become the delight of my eyes and they follow Allah's commandments. Thirdly, I pray for my children that they become the true servants of Islam. Fourthly, I pray for all my sincere friends by mentioning their names one by one. And then I pray for every member of my Jama'at. May Allah enable us to fulfill our obligations and our responsibilities and grant us the courage to emulate the life of our beloved Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and his true servant, Hazrat Masih Ma'ud alayhi salatu wasalam. I conclude with the prayer, Rabbana hablana min azwajina wa zurriyatina qurrata a'yun waj'alna lil muttaqina imama. Ameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah, very well delivered.